In order to learn more about how electricity is distributed throughout the grid, we're going to focus on how one particular small town in the center part of the U.S. gets its electricity. Right now, the map is showing all the power lines in the United States that have a voltage over 100 kilovolts. Therefore, we're not seeing all of the power lines because there are actually a lot of power lines with smaller voltages. Let's zoom in here to the boxed area and take a closer look at these power lines. This part of the U.S. is where four states come together, Nebraska, Iowa, Kansas, and Missouri. And you can see from the scale bar down there that this is not a very large geographical area. We have the Missouri River running down on the left side of the map, and we have two major metropolitan areas, Kansas City and St. Joseph. There are also a number of small towns in the map, and this is mainly a farming area. In a previous video, we looked at various power plants, and one of the reasons I chose this area is because there is quite a good mix here of power plants. We have coal, nuclear, solar, gas, wind, nearly everything here, also some petroleum plants. I want to focus on the larger power plants. We have three major coal generating plants, each of them over 1 gigawatt of nameplate capacity. There's one nuclear power plant here on the map, the Cooper nuclear plant with an 801 megawatt nameplate capacity. I also want to draw your attention to the Nottoway plant. This is a gas-fired plant. There are a lot of other gas-fired plants here on the map too that I'm not showing. This particular one will be important later when we see how a small town gets its power. The large gray areas you're seeing here on the map are wind turbines. Every little one of the little purple rings you're now seeing is the location of a substation. For example, this is what one of them looks like. This is the Skidmore substation. Substations have two basic functions. They transform voltages and they protect the grid. As you might recall from some of our previous videos, you know that it makes a lot of sense to use the power at lower voltages because it's safer, and it makes a lot of sense to transmit power at very high voltages because there's fewer power losses along the distribution lines. Substations are where the transformers are contained. We also have ancillary equipment like voltage regulators and switchgear. The second function of a substation is protection. If you have a fault on a power line, if a bird or an animal gets electrocuted and creates a fault, or if a storm knocks down a power line, it's very important to be able to isolate the fault from the rest of the electricity grid. That's what a substation can do. It contains things like fuses and circuit breakers. What I think is very interesting about this particular substation is the sign. If you look at this red sign here, it says, "Copper wire in this facility has been replaced with copper-clad steel, which has no scrap value." That means that people have actually broken into these substations just to steal the copper, because they can then take the stolen copper to a scrap metal dealer and try to get some money for it. I think it's just astonishing that people would want to break into such a dangerous facility, but evidently people do it. Let's now take a look at the high voltage transmission lines here in the region. In this region, the highest voltage is 345 kilovolts. These 345 kilovolt lines mainly run to and from the big power plants that I highlighted earlier. The turbines inside the power plants, though, don't generate electricity at 345 kilovolts. Typically, turbines will operate in the neighborhood of 10 kilovolts to 20 kilovolts. So all these power plants have step-up transformers just next to the power plant in order to get these high voltages needed for transmission. Let's now take a look at some of the lower voltage lines. You're now seeing all the power lines with voltages down to 69 kilovolts. These medium-sized power lines are mainly at 161 kilovolts and 69 kilovolts. Of course, this is not all the power lines in the region. There are a number of smaller distribution voltages. The three most common distribution voltages in this region are 4 kilovolts, 12.47 kilovolts, and 13.2 kilovolts. Those three voltages represent the last leg or the last power line before you reach the pole transformer that delivers the plus and minus 120 volts to the customer. What we're going to do in the rest of the video is focus on the town of Maitland, Missouri, population 276, and we're going to see where its electricity comes from. Let's start off here with a map of the United States and zoom into the little town of Maitland, Missouri. We're going to be starting here with the last power lines that are on the secondary side of this pole transformer on Elm Street. This neutral and plus and minus 120 volts would be delivered directly to a house or a group of houses. The primary side of this pole transformer is connected to one of three phases. Each of the three power lines at the top of the pole here is at 12.47 kilovolts. That's one of the most common final distribution voltages in this region. Where does this 12.47 kilovolts come from? Well, if we go west by a couple of hundred meters, we reach the Maitland substation. The Maitland substation is a rather simple substation because it only has one transformer. The secondary side of the transformer is connected to 12.47 kilovolts, and the primary side happens to be at 34.5 kilovolts. I can tell the secondary side apart from the primary side because the primary side of the transformer has larger bushings and the power lines are further off the ground. Where do these 45.5 kilovolt lines come from? Well, if we go west along Highway C and then south along Highway D a few kilometers, will bring us to the Browns Curve substation at the junction of Highway 113. This is a bigger substation. The secondary side of the substation is at 34.5 kilovolts, and the primary side of the substation is at 69 kilovolts. Again, it's very easy to tell the secondary and the primary side of the substation apart because the power lines on the primary side are at a higher voltage and thus sit further off the ground. Going back to our map of the power grid, the yellow line represents the connection between Maitland and the Browns Curve substation. The 69 kilovolt line leads to the Fairport substation, which you can see from the map is a fairly large substation with a number of different high voltage lines coming together. One of those power lines connects the Fairport substation to the Cooper nuclear facility. What we can conclude from the path I've drawn on the map here is that the little town of Maitland, Missouri gets some, perhaps most of its electricity from the Cooper nuclear facility. What would hypothetically happen though if the nuclear power plant needed to be taken offline for maintenance or refueling? Where would the little town get its electricity then? Well, the substation just outside of the nuclear power plant has a connection up here to the Nebraska City coal plant. That provides another source of power. The Fairport substation also has a 345 kilovolt connection down here to the Iatan coal-fired power plant. What would hypothetically happen though if the 69 kilovolt line shown here in blue were to have a fault? What would happen, say, if a tree were to fall on that power line? Where would the little town get its electricity then without that connection to the Fairport substation? Well, there's another connection over here to the Nottoway power plant, a gas-fired power plant. Of course, if enough of these power lines go down, then there's no hope, and they're going to have a blackout until the utility workers can go out and repair the damage. What I've hoped that you've seen from this map, though, is having a grid of power plants, substations, and power transmission lines is very important. The grid itself is actually extremely tolerant to faults. Usually, if just one power plant goes down, the electricity can flow around it through other connections, and that's very important for stability overall. We have a whole series of professionally filmed and edited videos in order to help students learn the fundamentals of electricity. If you like watching this particular video, then you might like to check out some of our others too.